In 2009, I was at Oxford University attending a conference about terrorism, and it came to my knowledge that the Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan was coming to give a lecture there. I went to the theater they were preparing for the event and found members of the Oxford University Islamic Society preparing the venue, putting up banners welcoming the Turkish Prime Minister and so forth. At the time for the afternoon prayers, all the Muslim volunteers went to pray together. I had already prayed the Asr prayer with the Dhuhr, which I combined because I'm traveling, so I did not go with them, and I noticed that one of the young Turkish volunteers had also not gone to pray. So I asked him, "Why didn't you go to pray with the others? Aren't you a student here in Oxford and a resident here?" He answered, "Yes, I'm a student here, but I do not pray because I am an atheist." I said, "Why do you say that? I assume you're a Muslim since you are volunteering with the Muslim students of the Islamic Society. Why do you call yourself an atheist?" He said, "You see, I'm studying biology here, and I believe in the theory of evolution. It wouldn't make sense for me to believe in the theory of evolution and pray, would it?" This incident actually made me go back to take a look at many opinions that had been voiced about evolution. However, before I start talking about that, let me first explain the difference between the meaning of evolution and the meaning of Darwinism. Evolution, in brief, says that the world started in the following way. A few molecules were present in a fluid similar to a sort of soup. Then these molecules came together to form a sort of bubble. And inside this bubble, the beginning of DNA or nucleic acid started to form. Next, this progressed to plants, and the plants started to produce oxygen. Of course, each of these steps took hundreds of millions of years. Inside the bubble and within the DNA, new species started to evolve, namely algae. These in turn sank into the bottom of the ocean and started to evolve into very primitive fish without scales or even eyes. Over time and through millions of years, these invertebrate fish started to evolve and acquired a vertebral column and acquired eyes as well. Fish continued to evolve and wanted to leave water to live on land. Consequently, lungs started to appear. Thus, new species arose, namely amphibians. These are animals that can live both in water and on land. Next, amphibians evolved into reptiles, which in turn grew and became dinosaurs. Dinosaurs then wanted to fly, so they acquired feathers. When dinosaurs became extinct, what was left of them was birds. Briefly, going back to reptiles. Concurrently, as some reptiles were evolving into dinosaurs, others were evolving into land-dwelling animal species such as rodents, bears, and anteaters. These branches of evolution continued to develop until they eventually gave rise to higher primates such as chimpanzees, who share a common ancestor with humans. This is what is called the theory of evolution. Darwinism adopts the theory of evolution but goes further by suggesting that some of the land-dwelling species gave rise to the next through random mutations. That process, according to Darwinists, was purely random. In this respect, randomness is the antithesis of God's design. Thus, Darwinists do not believe in God. According to them, evolution occurs through random mutations. The idea of there being no creator is not acceptable by religion or even by reason. There is, however, other scientists who believe that evolution is actually more of a process of development. There is someone who is developing species into other species. They believe that evolution is actually the way the creator has chosen to deal with his creation. Advocates of this school of thought state that God chose with his absolute will evolution as a means of bringing into existence all living beings through a lengthy process. They argue that if God has desired that all living beings, including ourselves, develop in this manner, then who are we to object? Actually, there are a number of Muslim scholars who address this issue as well. One of these is Ibn Khaldun. Ibn Khaldun mentioned in his Muqaddimah, which is a book called The Introduction, some very important things. He said, look at the realm of formation, how it started from elements, then plants, then animals in an exquisitely progressive way. The upper limit of the elements is connected to the lower limit of plants, such as grasses and seedless plants. And the upper limit of plants, such as palm trees, is connected to the lower limit of animals, such as snails and oysters, which only have the sense of touch. The meaning of connection here is that the upper limit of one is strangely prepared to become the lower limit of the next level. The animal kingdom then widened and its species increased in number, and it ended up in its progressive formation to the human being, who possesses both intellect and prudence. The upper limit of plants and the lower limit of animals in the evolutionary sequence is the palm, while the upper limit of animals and the lower limit of humans is the monkey. This was all mentioned in Ibn Khaldun's Muqaddimah, or introduction. Incidentally, Darwin himself states that what led him to research the topic of evolution is that when he was young, his father used to read to him from Ibn Khaldun's Muqaddimah. One of the contemporary scholars that addressed that issue is Dr. Abdul Sabur Shaheen. He stated that there is no problem with the notion of Adam being specially selected by Allah from amongst other human-like creatures who were also present at that time. He even supported this with the holy verse, Allah selected Adam, Noah, and the family of Abraham, and the family of Imran above all else in the world. The word translated as selected in this verse is the Arabic word istafa, which means more than merely to select, rather is to make discerning choice between someone or something from amongst others. Dr. Abdul Sabur Shaheen states that the fact that Allah discerningly chose Adam indicates that Adam may have been present amongst others like him, but who did not possess certain qualities and traits such as morality and free will, and that after selecting him, he infused into him a spirit or a soul. Animals have a spirit too, but animals do not have free will. So infusing Adam with divine spirit made him an intelligent human being, possessing morals and free will, and made his brain different from the brains of other species. The brain of an animal is just a brain. It is not a mind. In some countries, it is used to make sandwiches from. But you never come across mind sandwiches. But the brain of humans became a mind because of that superior infusion of divine spirit, which made him capable of thinking, capable of choosing between right and wrong, and capable of handling responsibility. Dr. Abdul Sabur Shaheen also quotes the holy verse, "And remember when your Lord said to the angels, 'I am going to create a man from mud. So when I have fashioned him completely and infused him with the spirit which I created for him, then fall you down prostrating yourselves unto him.' Thus, our Lord creates a human from clay. Then when he has perfected him and infused him with the spirit, only then do the angels prostrate themselves to him. Because now he has become intelligent, unlike other animals and creatures. Allah did not order the angels to prostrate for Adam as if he were a god, but rather as a new creature, a VIP who has superiority in knowledge. Dr. Muhammad Basil Attai, another scholar who addressed this matter, and he has evidence from the Quran of paramount importance which should be taken seriously, such as the evidence in Surah As-Sajdah, verses number 7, 8, and 9, which say, "And he started the creation of man from clay. Then he made his offspring from a fluid held in low esteem." It must be noted that the Arabic word thumma, which means then, denotes a slow sequence, or one event occurring after another but not directly, rather with an interval in between. So that means that there was a long period of procreation through mating between males and females. The verse continues saying, "Then," or thumma, or after a long period of time, "he fashioned him in due proportion and infused into him of his spirit." So choosing someone and perfecting him and infusing him with the spirit came after a long line of offspring and after generations of procreation through the mating of males and females. Here Dr. Basil Attai states that this is irrefutable evidence from the Quran to support the principle of evolution. So now we have three groups of people. The first is the Darwinians, who believe in evolution, which occurs purely randomly. Random mutations led to evolution of species from other species. Generally, Darwinians refuse to listen to any opinion that contradicts their own. They also do not have explanations for many things in the theory of evolution, such as how language evolved. They have no explanation for that. They say that 140,000 years ago, man started to give names to things. This issue is not explained except by the Holy Quran, which says, "And he taught Adam all the names." That is, at a certain point, Adam learned all the names of things language appeared. Even though Darwinians have no explanation for the phenomenon of language development, they claim that their theory has been proven beyond doubt, clear as daylight, and is evidenced by the fact that all scientists are Darwinians. But this is actually not true. Ben Stein in the United States made a wonderful film called Expelled. He spoke about thousands of school teachers and university professors who are non-Darwinians and who are banned from teaching and are prevented from meeting with their students and talking to them, while only the Darwinians are allowed to teach. These banned teachers and professors belong to the second group, which believe that there is an intelligent creator. As I mentioned, advocates of this idea believe that evolution is actually development and that it is the tool of the creator with his creations. Incidentally, Dr. Mustafa Mahmoud, who was a contemporary progressive Islamic thinker, is also an advocate of this school. As for the third group, they are those who believe in direct creation. They believe that God Almighty created each species individually. I wonder, who says that there can only be these three groups of theories? Why can there be a fourth or fifth theory? Dr. Muhammad Basil Al-Ta'i says some wonderful words in this regard. He states that the verses of the chapter 32 of the Quran, which I just read, can accommodate the principle of evolution, but not necessarily the theory of evolution. The theory that we just explained about the algae that became fish, and the fish that became amphibians, and the amphibians that became reptiles, and the reptiles that became dinosaurs, and the dinosaurs that became birds, and how reptiles also became animals, and some of them became primates, and primates became human beings. All of this is called the theory of evolution. He says that the Quran can accommodate the principle of evolution, but not necessarily this theory. And this theory could in fact be totally wrong, and there could be another totally different theory. Who says that Allah could not have created all this world through evolution, then created humans directly too? Thus, we would have a mix between the two theories. We would thus have more diversity and integration between number of theories. What I want to say here, and this is the purpose of this discussion, is that we must start to accept other points of view. I object to Darwinism, and there is no way religion can accept Darwinism yet. We must commend Darwin himself for his efforts. The Quran says, "Say, walk through the earth and see how creation began." He did not say, "Sit in classes of Quran and see how creation began." Thus, man must explore and discover and spend time in labs looking into microscopes in order to perceive. Well, Darwin left his home in Scotland for 5 years. He boarded a ship and went down to South America and circled it and went to the Galapagos Islands. He collected fossils, plants, and insects, then went down to the Far East and continued all the way to Australia, then went back to Scotland. A 5-year trip to perceive how creation started. We commend Darwin for his scientific efforts, but we disagree with certain parts of his theory. Indeed, large parts of Darwin's theory explain the crucial principles of botany and zoology. However, Darwinism as an ideology that does not accept the existence of the creator cannot be accepted by religion. However, we can accept as Muslim anyone who says evolution is the tool of God in creation, as long as he believes that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his final messenger. Thank you so much.